This week, new meets old as we see a state-of-the-art chapel conversion here in the Tamar Valley, a hidden corner of the countryside where Devon meets Cornwall.
You could say that this part of the country is a well-kept secret. It's quiet and exceptionally beautiful. It's away from the main tourist routes and hasn't seen the property development that much of Devon and Cornwall have. Gavin Allen and Jane Fitzsimons live in Birmingham and are a typical professional couple. They both work long hours, spending their time in the office or on the road. Gavin, who's Cornish born and bred, is a senior management consultant and spends his time moving from one client to the next. Jane, who's pregnant with their first child, is originally from Northern Ireland. She's a sales manager for a technology company and divides her time between her clients and the Birmingham office. They own this house in Birmingham, where they've been living together for 8 years. They plan to continue living here for the duration of the build, whilst visiting the site every other weekend to keep an eye on progress. Although they'd wanted to move to the southwest for some time, they couldn't find the right house. Then they found this disused Methodist chapel, which they bought at a local auction. The plan is to move here and eventually work from home.
Hi guys, how are you?
Not too bad.
Great, nice to see you. How's the baby?
Yeah, fine, I think. Still in there, which is good.
Fantastic place. Absolutely beautiful.
No, it is nice, especially on a clearer day. It's a bit misty.
Well, yeah, but nevertheless, it really is fabulous.
Mm. Yeah.
These are your front door keys.
This is, eh?
I don't believe it. Look at that. Yeah. That's what you get when you buy a house like this. Look at that. Solid.
Right. Should we go in and have a look?
Yeah. Oh, look. How old is it, the place?
Built 1907.
All right, so it's relatively new, really.
Yeah.
As churches go.
This is basically as we found, nothing's been changed since we've been here.
Wonderful, huge space, isn't it?
Yeah. What that's what appealed to us when we first saw it, was these sort of beams and just the whole feeling of light and space, really.
What are these strange white things on the walls?
The hands. This is to help with, I think, controlling the damp. Basically, you turn that on, the air sort of actually comes up and circulates around the building, helps carry the heat.
So, if it isn't cold enough in January, in the middle of a service,
yeah,
you just...
We're not paying attention.
Yeah.
This side of the building is going to be accommodation, but this side is going to be open, so we can see all the way up to the roof.
Fantastic. A lot of glass. It's going to be a very light house when it's done, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, it's because the view is one of the best things about here, as well as the space inside the building. So it seems to all shade the block the view out.
Well, look, should we downstairs? Yeah. And you say that the space extends right under the main floor. Good grief. These cobbles.
Yeah.
They're fantastic.
Yeah.
Where are you going to keep them?
I'm going to keep them and either use them in some of the other flooring area where the garden's going to be.
Yeah.
Or potentially even in walls or whatever, but we're definitely going to keep them and use them.
Okay. Yeah. This has been used as what, a garage or something, is it?
No, play school.
This was a play school.
Oh my God.
As you can see from the paintings,
Cornish play school. They bring them up tough, don't they? Very exciting space, isn't it?
It is, with so much.
Show me through here. You said that there are three voids in here.
Very much like this.
Yeah.
But I think it's the structural walls for the outside.
But we can't get in then.
Not at the moment.
Not at the moment.
But we will do, because we're having sort of doors put in either side and rooms.
It's great, this. It's kind of very cool, isn't it? Very still.
Yeah.
Good for a wine cellar.
Well, don't start things now. We've got enough to think about without paying for a wine, haven't we?
I think we'll need copious amounts of wine after we pay for this.
So you don't need a cellar for that.
Although the interior will change completely, the outside will only have new windows added and a sun deck offering magnificent views of the Tamar Valley. Inside the main body of the chapel, some of the floors will be removed, giving a clear view from basement to roof. One side of the space will be left open, and the other will have a grand staircase leading up to a block of bedrooms and a library and office. There will also be an indoor sunken garden beneath the stairs. The old Sunday school will become the main living area, and above that will be the master bedroom. The brief is to create a light, spacious interior without altering the original shell of the chapel. The chapel and land cost £83,000, They've arranged a mortgage of £120,000 to cover the cost of the build.
For you, Gavin, is there a sense of coming home? Is it sort of, you know, coming full circle?
I suppose so. That's quite a romantic way of putting it. But I never really liked living in away from home. I feel like quite an attachment to the area.
The difference for me, I call Birmingham home, you call Cornwall home. So I suppose that's a slight difference of feeling. Your father's down, there's tenants down the road.
Yeah, that's handy. Yeah, my brother lives in Plymouth as well, so... Yeah, it is nice being able to do this.
So had you thought of self-build?
We'd started to look into it, but probably not in that much detail. So it was a bit of an impulse decision when we saw it, and we thought we'd go to the auction and just see, well, what the hell, you know.
And how did you choose an architect? How did you get hold of one?
I think we saw
about
eight.
Eight in the end. It was between him and sort of one other guy. We were very torn between the two. We just felt that David, in the end, was the one that we felt we could probably have arguments with and still get on with at the end.
When you see some of David Shepherd's work, it's not hard to see why Gavin and Jane chose him. He built this house overlooking the Plymouth Sound. Where possible, he likes to use local materials. Outside, the house is made from local stone, cemented together using the clay dug from the foundations. The interior uses local timber, which combined with metal fittings and a large glass roof, give the house a strong contemporary look. The most striking feature is the indoor garden and stream. A selection of desert plants surrounded by rammed earth walls give it an almost Mexican feel. Not only was David architect, but he also project managed the build, something that he plans to do for Gavin and Jane. So effectively, they're putting the whole build, including the finances, in his hands. I visited him at an artist's studio he's recently converted.
How much is trust important to you in working with a client?
Paramount importance. Trust, because you're dealing with someone's money, they're almost their life savings. I mean, the biggest investment that most people make in their life is in their house. And you're responsible for hundreds of thousands of pounds, literally. And I always feel rather humble dealing with that kind of money. I mean, it's not probably not a lot, huge amount of money if you're working on stock exchange, but it's someone's personal money that they've saved really hard for or worked hard for. And you've got to convert that into a built product that they'll also be very pleased with.
Why are you being Mr. Project Manager on the job?
I don't consider myself a project manager. I consider it just as being an extension of my job as an architect.
So for you it's a natural extension of that. Do you do that every time you work on a project?
More often than not, because particularly in this part of the world, people have a reasonably limited budget. And therefore, if you're employing other consultants on a project, it could become prohibitive. And it gives me total control as well of what is being done and to whom we are going to for various tenders.
One of Gavin and Jane's concerns was radon, an underground gas found particularly in granite. It can permeate into buildings through their foundations, and in concentrated amounts it may cause lung cancer. First readings show the levels are over the accepted limit. If it's confirmed, a ventilation system will need to be installed to suck the gas out of the house. This will cost £2,000. But it's better to be safe than sorry. Particularly, as shortly afterwards, Jane gives birth to their first child, a boy called Sam.
This is the cause of all the problems.
Yeah, Sam arrived, where was it, 11:47 on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
He came actually a week early.
What a delight.
And came home yesterday afternoon. I spent most of the time, luckily, asleep since then, which we're really relieved about. But he's totally oblivious to it. He doesn't give a stuff, does he? Mm. It's only us that are bothered about it.
Making a jump.
Oh, is he?
Yeah.
As project manager, one of David Shepherd's first jobs is to arrange the building contractor. With them on board, the first thing to do is to tear out all existing unwanted features in the chapel. It'll prepare the way for the new design, but also gets to the heart of the building and makes sure it's in good condition to provide a solid base for the new house. It's the equivalent of building the foundations in a new build. demolition has revealed the enormous amount of unused space that David intends to incorporate in the new house. Now the basement is exposed, he takes the opportunity to check the plan for a radon barrier with the building inspector.
And what I'm slightly concerned about is your radon requirements, insofar as radon barriers and things like that.
There aren't any.
There aren't any?
Not for a conversion, no.
Oh, right.
If you're replacing all the floors, we'd normally recommend you put radon in at that stage, but there's no requirement to do it.
Right.
Not having to install major radon defences will save money. But for caution, they're still going to install a basic protection system.
So there's basically three levels. Yeah.
Gavin and Jane are making their first visit since demolition began. They can really start to appreciate the size of the house they will one day live in.
Stairs are in the middle though. It's going to make a real big feature of them. It's going to be brilliant. I think our bedroom's going to be huge. Just trying to picture that better now above here. Because obviously the roof's been taken out.
Gavin and Jane are keen to get an update from David as to how the two major parts of the build, the staircase and the windows, are progressing. David has had an idea to make the banisters out of glass. But although dramatic designs are one thing, cost is another.
That should all work up. We've got a preliminary price. It's going to cost you probably, including the glass handrails, which have to be in laminated glass, and then all the spaces as well. It's going to cost about $8,000.
And what was it we had in the budget for it?
Five and a bit, I think.
But that's an estimate, is it? Is that an estimate based on somebody just looking at it?
No, from the drawings, you know, in their experience, they could give you a reasonable quote.
Just because we've saved some money on the radon, I don't want to think we're just going to burn it up on something else.
No.
Mm. I understand things do cost money, but, understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If I'm saving money, I want to see it in my pocket rather than it going on to another contractor, if I can.
Yeah. $18,000. For the windows.
And what would it be?
24.
24.
Which is pretty good.
Is that down to, obviously, it's a simpler design now as well?
Yes, it is. Yeah,
it's a combination of the two then, really.
I'm going to be really boring now. Coming back to the cost again then. The original 24,000 was just for the carpentry, was it?
Correct.
Right.
Okay. Yeah.
So that is a like for like.
That's right.
Comparison.
Mm. Yeah. Because you've got glazing.
I know, I bore you to death and I ask you about it. But I have to know.
I can't sleep at night.
Once we've actually clarified all the costs, both for the stair and the windows,
we'll
know exactly how much we've got left in the pot. Mm-hmm. It's difficult because, you know, I'm left with the job of being like a QS as well, as well as the contracts manager, as well as the architect, it seems. So it's going to take a bit of time to get all that together, but we can save money, I know that. And we've, you know, we're starting to do it.
Yeah.
I mean, we know what figure we've got to work to, and that's the most important thing.
This build is altogether rather complicated. It combines a very adventurous design with an old building and on a tight budget. And David's got two hats to wear. He's responsible for all the creative input and for the financial and project management. What with Gavin and Jane determined not to overspend, I'd say he's got a very tough job.
Any bids at all? 17,750. At 17,750, it's hard, sir. 18? At 18,000. 18,250. At 18,250. Against you, sir? At 18,250.
Gavin and Jane bought the chapel at an auction like this one in Plymouth.
At 18,500, the starter. At 18,750.
Auctions are not for everybody. You've got to think fast and make decisions under pressure. One false nod could be a fatal mistake. However, if you can keep your head, then you could find yourself coming away with your dream home and at a bargain.
23. £44,000. £44,000 a bid.
People are wary of auctions, with good reason, because you can run the risk of either ending up with a property that's nothing but problems, or one you didn't even want in the first place. But they do have their good points. They're quick, you can move in just 4 weeks after the gavel goes down, and by avoiding the estate agent, they're cheaper too.
$49,500, the last time.
Mike, how easy is it to buy a property at auction?
Very easy indeed. It's a very simple and clinical operation, but it does mean that you've got to prepare for yourself very well indeed. Because once the gavel goes down, you can't come back to the owner or to me and say, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't realise there was dry rot, or I didn't realise the extension had got no planning consent. You ought to know these things. You ought to have found them out before the auction. The most important thing is you've got to be a cash buyer. Because once the gavel goes down, you've got to pay a 10% deposit today, and within 4 weeks, you've got to pay the balance. And if you don't, just as in private treaty sales, you've got penalties, which can mean that you can lose your deposit if you don't get it right.
What techniques do you use as an auctioneer to get the bidding up?
Let me tell you, an auctioneer, the only qualifications really for an auctioneer is 2 years at RADA. Because most of it is the technique of trying to persuade the audience that you have a bidder, when in fact you haven't got a bidder.
29,000 I have over here.
But once I get up to the reserve price, I mustn't do it.
Right.
And therefore it's open to the market, open to what is happening in the room.
So, if you think that buying at auction is for you, then remember three things. First, get your money sorted out well in advance. Second, make sure that you know the property and you know everything about it. And third, know your limit and don't bid above it.
Gavin and Jane did have a survey before they bought the chapel, although it was just a basic one. But old buildings are always unpredictable, as Andy McGoldrick, who runs the building company, knows all too well.
On the whole, the project's gone very well. It's we're pretty much on budget and on programme.
Is it reasonable to assume that when you work with an old building, you are going to find hidden things? I mean, there are going to be problems of damp and a few structural problems that you can't discover.
Very much so, yeah. It's one of the risks you stand. The standards that the modern buildings are made to these days are obviously far superior because they know all about things like damp and dry rot and all the rest of it. So they're designed out of the newer buildings. But with an older building such as this, whilst it's got tremendous character and lovely old stone and all the rest of it, the big danger is you don't know what you're going to find.
With demolition underway, they discovered a big problem. A steel lintel supporting an entire structural wall has corroded beyond use and needs to be replaced. It's too early to tell how expensive this will be, but the build presses on.
This morning, we're off to pick up the timber for the long-awaited staircase, which is the centrepiece of the design.
David does like to use local materials, and the staircase is no exception. It's going to be made out of Douglas fir that's grown in woodland just minutes away from the chapel.
I hadn't expected the staircase to be so massive. I mean, look at the size of these timbers, they're huge. But by the end of the day, they're going to be completely unrecognisable.
Once the bark has been cut off, the wood is sawn into blocks that will become the steps.
With the skin off, you can really appreciate the beautiful colour and the grain of the Douglas fir. And with a bit of planing, these beautiful great lumps will be ready to put into the staircase.
It took the sawmill weeks to find trees tall enough to make these supporting beams for the staircase. They stand at over 30 feet. Back at the chapel, the builders are working on the internal walls, putting up the frames of the bedrooms that'll be behind the stairs.
Oh, it's
full of scaffolding.
Yeah.
It's 3 months since the build started. The timber has been cleaned, revealing it in all its glory. Gradually, the house is starting to resemble the end product, but with scaffolding, it's almost impossible to tell what goes where. Gavin and Jane had to do their best to explain it to me.
The verticals are going to go all the way up to the roof.
So what's the hole?
That's the dungeon for Sam, so...
So what's down below? There's a playroom down below?
Yes, yeah, playroom.
It's going to be fully sealed so we can flood it.
You can just watch it stand here, and like the Titanic, watch it fill up with water. I mean, how child-friendly is this house going to be?
We are going to have to invest in a number of stair gates, I think, bearing in mind where all the angles the stairs come from and things like that.
Just come and explain this to me, because I'm still not quite convinced as to how the stairs are going to work.
Okay. Well, it's quite tricky really to describe this, but basically the stairs start in the basement, down below us there, and basically open outwards towards the front and back of the building to this level that we're actually on where the bedrooms are. And there's a platform between... at that level, and then they go back in and join up at the next level of the bedrooms.
Like a big diamond?
Like a big diamond,
right, yeah. Okay, so it's not that difficult structurally?
No.
And where's baby sleeping?
In the room just here on our left-hand side.
What, just on
this one here?
Right, just here. Generally, is the build going as you expected it to?
Well, the quality of the work so far appears to be pretty good. Mm-hmm. You know, we're pleased with that and the speed. I mean, they're really cracking through it.
So you're on schedule?
Yeah, we're on schedule, yeah, at the moment.
So how's the financial side of things?
Unfortunately, we're slightly over of where we'd like to be at the moment due to some unforeseen circumstances, like replacing some joists and some damp-proofing, the things we had to do. But we're hoping to get some of that back at the next stage of the project. And if we can't get all of it back, then obviously we're just going to have to try and find some extra funds.
OK, but is that going to be a problem, finding extra money?
Well, it depends how much we have to find, but we've got some ideas.
So who's organising the finances? Who's running the finances of the project?
We are now, aren't we?
Well, David's doing, the day-to-day management, but when it comes down to it, the ones that really care about the money is us, obviously, because it's our money. So we're working very closely with David on that.
So are you happy?
I mean, I'm happy with the quality of the work and the speed that they're doing it. I guess the thing that always causes stress, or certainly causes stress for people like Gavin and I, is obviously the money side of things. And I think I'll feel a lot better once we've done the windows and the stairs, because they're sort of
big chunks of the money we've got to spend.
And then I'll sort of feel we've got, you know, the biggest amount of cash out of the way.
Do you feel you've spent a lot already?
I feel we've spent a lot. And
we've spent a lot, but we're still a long way away, aren't we?
Yeah.
It feels.
Yeah. One of the case.
In the new year, one of those big chunks, the staircase, starts to go in.
The staircase that's coming in now is an incredibly strong visual and structural part of the building. It's linking the rooms on the ground floor and upstairs, but it's also linking this open space here and the closed spaces, which are the bedrooms over there. It's going to turn it from a building into a house.
Yeah. Is that a bit tight still? Do you want to take a bit more off?
Yeah. Okay. Ready? Hold it. Okay, big down. Is it the cup?
Because of the early overspend, Gavin and Jane have taken control of the money management, formulating spreadsheets at home in Birmingham and communicating with David over all build costs. They are skilled in financial management, but it's going to be hard to claw back some of the overspend that this old building has caused them.
The major problem with converting an old building is that you can't plan for all those hidden faults until you start building. You can have a contingency fund, but that can easily get swallowed up in all the things you don't see, things like keeping the building standing and waterproof. Before work started, these basement walls, which support the whole building, were totally concealed, so it was impossible to tell that they were leaking water badly, or that the entire ground floor needed to be replaced because of dry rot. And to cap it all, the steel lintel that was here that supported this huge wall had to be ripped out and replaced by this concrete one at enormous cost. In fact, when the last invoice came in,
Gavin and Jane found the lintel ended up costing £6,500, meaning the unforeseen costs have totaled £20,000, a huge sum that has soaked up all their contingency fund. Part of the problem is their mortgage. It's paid in four stages at agreed points in the build. The £20,000 overspend has meant that, without getting a short-term loan, they won't have the money to progress to the next stage of the build. This in turn would mean that they'd be unable to get the next payment from the mortgage company. More importantly, Gavin and Jane have analysed the budget in detail and are concerned that even more overspend is inevitable. Stopping the project has now become a very real option.
I would describe it as very, very, very stressful at the moment. And it feels very much like we're under continual pressure, because the decisions we have to make are very difficult ones. Mm. And as a Cornishman, it's affecting my pocket, which always stresses me.
I mean, we're sort of thinking that, I suppose, any sort of build is like a game of poker or something, you know, and at the moment the stakes are getting nearly a little bit too high for us. And that's where we've got to try and get somewhere where, you know, we've got the right balance. I think we're at the point at the moment where if somebody said to me, came up to me tomorrow and said, you know, I'll take it off your hands, I would just say, take it. But I know at the moment we're going through a real low, and I've got to sort of try and keep it in perspective, but that's certainly how I feel at the moment. It's one extra thing that I think I could do without. And, you know, once we see an end in sight, whatever that end is, it's going to be a lot better. But at the moment we don't know what it is, and it makes it very hard to deal with.
It's not worth going through what we're going through now, because there's so much more at stake than just the chapel. Mm. The things that are at stake are Sam's future, my future, Jane's future.
Ever having the time to enjoy it, because we're going to be working all the hours consent until we're 65.
And there was an excitement about it. There still is an excitement about it to a certain extent, about what it could be, but there are things that aren't worth giving up for it.
Walking around the site, there's a palpable air of tension here. Gavin and Jane are in Plymouth today meeting David Shepherd, trying to decide how and if the build will proceed. Gavin and Jane are trying to hammer out a revised budget with David Shepherd so they can get an increased loan from the mortgage lender. For now, there's enough money to keep the workers on site for 3 weeks. They're putting all their efforts into finishing the staircase, which, as a crucial part of the structure, must be completed. David believes the staircase will raise the value of the building and help to get the extra money. It's now almost completed. As the steps climb higher, the design can at last be appreciated. But on a day that should have been a celebration, news about the new loan arrives.
It's Monday evening, and I'm in Birmingham. Now, on Friday, Gavin and Jane received a phone call from the Building Society to say that they would not stump up all the money that Gavin and Jane needed to complete the build. Now, this could throw the whole thing into jeopardy. However, this morning, there was another phone call, which could be a reprieve. Who knows? I've come to find out.
So, Jane, what has happened?
It's more like what hasn't happened. It's been pretty awful, actually. As you know, we had applied to the Building Society for more money.
Yeah.
Because of the unexpected things that came up and whatever.
How much money?
£54,000.
That's a huge amount.
I got the call on Friday afternoon at 4:45 on the M40 on the way back from a training course, to say basically that they couldn't give me the 54. So, of course, you can imagine at 4:45 on a Friday, you can't do anything about it Monday morning. So it's been quite a sort of tense weekend.
Now, I've come all this way this evening because you've had another phone call.
Well, I called them this morning. They've basically agreed to release a total of 157 and a half.
So you're how much short of what you need?
16,000.
And that's to do the whole thing?
Yeah.
So what are you going to do?
Not do the whole thing.
Exactly.
So we had already had sort of preempted we mightn't get all the money. So we've already sort of put together a short list of things potentially we could cut out.
So why has it gone so far over? Because you've overspent 20, mm-hmm. okay, that's 15 more than your reserve, but you're asking for an extra 54,000. Why so much?
The rest of it basically comes out from things that were under-budgeted, is what's behind it. We've gone through the spreadsheet in real detail with both the builders and David and everybody else involved. We found out that basically the engineers that we got in to budget it, I think what they did was basically use standard values from the reference books they have, and basically they didn't take into account the complexities involved in an old building. So the windows were, which as you know was going to be a big part of the budget, were probably under budgeted by about, you know, just under 10,000. The stairs were under budgeted as well. All the big bits that we knew were going to cost were under budgeted.
Gavin and Jane worked out with David Shepherd that the combination of overspend and under budgeting means they need 54,000 more to complete the build. The mortgage lender's final offer is 38,000. They now have to work out how they can lose the 16,000 from their build budget, which means some very serious penny pinching. Now, last time I came down to the chapel, you weren't there. You were in a heavy meeting all day with David. So how is your relationship with him now? Is it strained?
It's different, obviously, it started off, and that we're so actively involved with the finance now. It is a different sort of relationship. It's still very open, and it's still very clear, because it's got to be if we want to get through this. And he is totally committed to helping us get through it. I mean, he knows that, you know, we started it together and we've got to end it together as well, you know, for better or worse, but like a marriage, I suppose, in a way.
So you've had lots of frank discussions.
Oh yes, very heated discussions.
Raised
emotional
voices.
Ones, you know, from both part sides, you know, and but you've got to do that to get through it.
So is it no longer your grand design? Has it turned into a nightmare?
A grand folly.
Yeah.
Yes and no. I mean, it's David keeps trying to gee us up again by telling us how wonderful the stairs look and stuff, and at the moment I really don't give a toss what they look like, to be perfectly blunt. You know, in one way, if somebody came to me tomorrow and said, we'll take this off your hands, I'd be quite pleased. There still is an underlying thing, though, that, you know, it's a project we started and I still want to finish it, as long as it's not going to kill us doing it.
Gavin and Jane have obviously got a lot on their plate, but of course David Shepherd's also involved, so I've come to Plymouth to see him to get his side of the story. And so far you've been the architect and you've been the project manager on the job. I mean, do you think that the two jobs are exclusive, that one person can't do both?
Yes. Is the answer to that. And the reason being is that we did look at the possibility of having a quantity surveyor, and yeah. His role is to monitor the costings of the project. I'm in fact doing that job. Although we're trained to actually monitor costs, perhaps not in the degree that one should. And hence that's why the quantity surveyor is a quantity surveyor and I'm an architect.
How has your relationship changed with them through the build and through this crisis?
Like a kind of marriage, we've had incredible disagreements, and particularly the meeting that we had that went on all day and some of the night, that was very put a great deal of pressure on them more than me, I think, purely on the basis they drove all the way down from Birmingham, stayed with me all day, and drove all the way back.
Whilst Gavin and Jane attempt to resolve the finances, they've ordered work on site to halt. Andy McGoldrick decided it would cost more to move off-site and back again, so he's taken a risk and kept work ticking over in the hope that money will come soon. Typically, where money's concerned, Gavin and Jane waste no time in sorting it out.
We've got the go-ahead, then, to get the money that we need. Great. OK, well, that's good news. I'll have to tell Gavin, obviously, when he gets in. So, thanks for that, and what I'll do, I'll give you a call over the next day or so we can start arranging how we move forward. Thanks a lot. Bye. So that was good news anyway. That was, as you know, we had problems with our original lender, who was a building society, in that they basically couldn't give us the rest of the money that we needed to finish the project. So we really had no other route to go but to find another lender to get the money. So we've been talking to various banks and building societies, and we just found out that the bank that we've gone for can actually give us the money we need. So, which is brilliant. So at least we've got the money to move forward now. So that's good.
Now they have the extra 54,000, Gavin and Jane have decided no building work will be given clearance until they have got full quotes. They hope this will prevent any further unexpected overspend.
I put some budgets in.
All right, well, if there's still big amounts, as we said in the letter, that we won't just ride off into the yonder just because we've got a plan. Yeah. Until we know what the overall cost is and we've got quotations to back it up.
Yeah.
We'll go with that.
You should have the rest of those tomorrow.
Yeah, by the end of the week.
Hours after the meeting, urgent work is underway, fixing the roof and putting new Velux windows in place. Because the mortgage valuation placed more emphasis on the stairs than the roof, the builder's been back to front. The roof leaked and some steps became mouldy. If you're choosing a mortgage, remember that the surveyor is the key to releasing your funds. He must understand what you're trying to do. For example, Gavin and Jane had decided not to build the decking in order to cut back on overspend. The new surveyor, recommended by David, pointed out that for a build cost of under £3,000, £7,000 would be added to the building's value. Some quotes still have not come in, and without them, Gavin and Jane won't release the money. For Andy McGoldrick, director of the building firm, the delays are proving frustrating.
How's it all going, Andy? Because you haven't finished yet.
It hasn't gone smoothly, but then again, you always get problems. Each building, each job has its own individual problems.
You were just brought in to do, first of all, the groundworks, weren't you? And your role has increased and increased until finally you've emerged, as it were, as a sort of third member of the group. You know, there's the architect, there's the client, there's you. What are the key things that you need out of these people?
Communication and trust, undoubtedly. In a nutshell, those two items.
Did you find the experience of not being there until the last lap frustrating?
Yes, very much so. It was a very difficult line to tread. We're used to having almost complete autonomy. You land on site, you get the spec, you've got the drawings, you know exactly where your responsibilities do and don't lie. This has been more of a learning experience all the way, because you don't want to tread on the architect-client relationship. But there are also times when will one of you please make a decision, you know? So yes, it has been frustrating.
So what's your story so far?
Insofar as what?
Insofar this troubled build.
Well, it has been in trouble, but not anymore.
You're happy?
Reasonably so. I'm just a bit concerned about timing. Yeah. We're obviously going to go over time, and it's going to take a few more weeks before we get it sort of complete, particularly with the major structural problems that we had initially. Yeah. And we've always been trying to retrieve that position, which seems to be an upending, non-ending struggle.
Yeah.
But the build is also late because the last quote for plumbing doesn't arrive until early May. At last, the build can continue at full speed. The heating and electrics are underway, and all the window frames have been completed except for the master bedroom windows where the holes are still being made.
To begin with, this chapel was going to be finished by Christmas. Then it was going to be ready in March. We're now at the end of May. Now, this project has always been very ambitious and the design is very exciting, but it is running 5 months behind schedule. So it's time to see how far they've got. Hi there.
Hi.
How's it going?
Great.
It's, looking around, not hugely finished where I'm standing, but it is plastered, you know?
It's plastered.
It's getting there, isn't it? The windows are about to go in.
Yep.
Yeah? Show me the rest of the house. Show me what condition that's in. Well, this is more like it, isn't it? This is a transformation.
It's come on quite a bit, hasn't it, since the
last
time
you were here? It's fabulous. Yeah, it looks almost finished. Is it?
No. The easy answer.
No, we've got a lot to do yet.
I mean, it should be at least another couple of weeks, don't you think?
Oh, at least, yeah. I don't care anymore, really. As long as it comes in, you know, and we're not destitute for the rest of our lives.
Yeah. I mean, but it does work, doesn't it? I mean, it's a stunning design. There's no doubt. And the stairs are amazing.
Yeah.
And they completely make the space. And it's light.
And it's much lighter than when I saw it last before the glazing went in.
Yeah. Mm.
And that's made a big difference to having clear glass.
It works beautifully. Show me the
garden.
Okay.
Oh, this is nice. This is sort of gently sloping away, isn't it?
Mm, it's dark. Pretty, isn't it?
Yeah. And the Streptocarcus is it's fantastic.
It's lovely, it's a flower. Isn't it? The colours are beautiful.
And even though it's sunken, it must get a fair bit of light because you've got these windows all the way around it and the door there when that's open. And you've got these four skylights as well.
Yeah.
They must quite well, blast it with quite a lot of light.
Yeah, that's what they're there for.
Really? That's why you put them garden. In?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It works beautifully. This is your heavenly garden.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
This was heavenly as it's going to get, I guess.
Can I have a look around the rest of the house?
Yeah, go ahead. Feel free. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks. Even when the banisters are in, I wonder how practical these stairs will be for a young child. Despite the size of this house, I can't get over how small the bedrooms are. I suppose architects so often consider bedrooms as secondary spaces. But I prefer myself to have a bedroom that's large enough to throw your clothes on the floor and have a cupboard. I can understand a baby's room being small, but surely not the master bedroom that's positioned over the open-plan living room. This room, you know, it isn't the largest room in the house. I'd have thought for your master bedroom you'd have kind of created this huge space.
Well, I mean, we probably would have liked to have one ideally, but the reason it's the size it is we couldn't have the floor any lower because of the heights of the windows down below.
Right,
so that reduces usable space. And we had to have this wall here because of the divide. You know,
between
this is basically the size we had, and we did give sort of one of the clear instructions we give to David at the start was not to cut across any of the chapel windows. But I still think it was going to be a workable room anyway.
Mm. And the view makes up for it.
And the view's just wonderful. I mean, just waking up in the morning, looking down the valley, it's going to be lovely.
The office space is open and light, and just seeing how the living room, kitchen and great hallway work together makes me appreciate the tremendous space this house has. Converting any older building inevitably involves some kind of compromise. And in a typical chapel conversion, you find the building chopped into layers so that you get large rooms with low ceilings, but you also get to see the windows sliced through by all the floors. Now, David's solution to this is to divide the building vertically, which means that although you do get small little rooms over on that side of the building, you do get to see large windows here, plus you get a sense of all that soaring height. On the whole, I think it's a pretty good compromise. But I still have one more question about the design of the building. Come and show me the playroom.
Okay.
Yeah, Sam's little room down here. Where we're walking, this used to be a great black void, didn't it?
It did,
I remember,
yeah.
We saw it. It's now, it's the opposite of that.
It's like all, a dungeon thing for
it's me. Wonderful now. This is a very decent-sized room, isn't it, to contain him in. Yeah. He's playing down here, you're upstairs reading the paper. He falls over, or tries to climb out the window. What are you going to do? Because you've got to run all the way down the other end of the house, all the way down here, over your gravel drive.
Sort of a self-healing kind of problem, isn't it? By the time we get there, it'll probably be all right.
Sort of installing a fireman's pole.
Or we just lean over and shout at him.
Say, shut up. We're trying to read the paper.
How many kids have you had before?
None. Mm. We may never have any more again.
Well, if we could be far enough away, we might not even hear him anyway.
you hope. I think this house is beautiful. I have nothing else to say really than that. I think it really is beautiful. And I was just wondering how you both feel about it.
I was wondering when the question was going to come. Very short interview. Happy with the house, I guess.
Yeah, happy with the house, not with the process. Mm. The design bit was fine. That all went well. And that we gave David criteria, and you know, I think he did an excellent job with trying to sort of achieve the design criteria. The issue was the cost criteria. And that's where I guess it all started to crumble.
Mm. Here you were in Birmingham. He was down here running this job, designing it.
For a period.
For a period. Do you think the fact that you were that far away made a significant difference? Didn't help?
Yes, because we didn't have a decent project manager down here.
With the benefit of hindsight, what advice could you give to somebody who was coming into the same situation as you?
Direct communication is the key thing.
Mm.
We deal directly with Andy McGoldrick. And if there's something that we don't know, we ask him. And we get to the point where you actually know what specifically what the answer is that you're looking for. Because we're not building people. So how we ask a question needs to be interrogated so you get to the bottom line of what we're after.
Mm. I think interview a load of architects, which is what we did. I think it's the right thing to do.
Interview them. And if you shortlist, go and see the work they've done.
And
speak to the people who they've done it to.
Because again, we might have had we would definitely have had a different picture if we'd spoken to the house that David took us to. Because we know they went significantly over budget as well.
Mm. Effectively taking references.
Yeah.
And what kind of preparation did you do before you engaged David?
In terms of what?
Well, in terms of, I don't know, understanding about how to go about having a house built, for example.
Well, we'd got some of the, the building magazines and stuff, the that home building one, that was quite useful because that does a lot of case studies and things and went through a lot of that. I mean, I contacted some of the architects, the RIBA and stuff, and asked their advice.
I mean, did none of them mention the fact that to have an architect also work as your project manager is not a good idea?
They don't specifically say that. You have to go with, at some point you have to make a decision. And we did that. And it was a wrong one, as it turned out.
Gavin and Jane spent £83,000 on the site. So far, the build is £54,000 over budget, with costs coming to £174,000. The total is £257,000. But it does look as though it will be financially worthwhile, as early estimates put the final value of the chapel between £260,000 and £300,000. But of course, building our own house is about more than money.
In a nutshell, two words, a project manager. You need some kind of interface between the architects, that's what I want it to look like, the clients, that's what I can afford to build, and the builder, that's what can physically be done.
Would you do it again? Would you project manage a job like this again, as well as design it? Do you think that the work is...
You always called it project management, but I always say it's architecture. It's always having control, to be the lead consultant. That's important. That's important, one, for the overall aesthetic, for the overall detail, for the overall comprehension of the building. It's not a project manager, that is the architect's job.
How much do you think the dream's going to be, in the end, compromised, if at all, by what's happened?
I think, like with most bad things, you end up getting over it. I'm not overjoyed, because we're still halfway through it and there's loads of things to do. And too much has happened to be overjoyed.
I think once the builders go and we can actually sort of, be in it properly and it's a home, everything's in, not necessarily fully decorated, but, we've got enough in it that we feel it's a home, then we can start to enjoy it.
There's no doubt in my mind that Gavin and Jane should have employed a full-time project manager on this build. But the great irony of self-building is that you never really understand how to build a house until it's over. It's a complicated jigsaw of skills, design, communication, and trust. So you do need all the professional help you can get. But it's you that keeps the jigsaw together, which means being on top of everything and everyone. Ultimately, only you can drive your vision forward.